ramparts
we
were so gallantly
streaming.
It's red glare. The bombs. The bombs, bombs, bombs. Bombs. Bombs, bombs, bombs. Bursting.
In air. Gave proof through the night.
Gave proof. Proof.
Proof.
Proof.
Proof.
Proof. Through the night.
That.
Proof through the night.
Our.
Flag.
What?
Still.
Still. That's cheating.
That's American.
Hello. Home.
Home's home.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Did you get teary-eyed just now? You did.
Not for reasons that would be expected, I guess.
Say why. When did it happen? I said I dare you to say it.
Yeah, I think it was definitely the dare.
Where were we in the summer? So, what about that? What did that touch?
Well, I mean, you, there's that word land, and so that's just, you know, presumption that, you know, there are feet and people and beings on the land, and so I guess where is the where does the notion really reside
of the land
of the, because it's a presumption within that, you know, that coupling of words, rather. A lot of presumption. Yeah.
I wanted to start that way with you, because in some way I feel very much that all this stuff around the national anthem right now, what does it mean for me in this body, in this time in history, to sing and really to claim that song for myself? So then it means that for me, it should look like me, it should come from me, it should sound like some experience that I'm having in the world. And I'm wondering what that was for you just now. I didn't want to do it just I'm not trying to make fun of anything, but really to put myself inside those words and inside that story. And I wonder what that experience was for you just now, like to begin that way.
Well, it actually comes from the first time I heard the national anthem outside the country. It was the Olympics, 2008. Yeah, I was living in Portugal at the time. And it was actually really interesting because the Olympic coverage in Europe was completely different. I mean, you didn't get all these like montages of like, you know, missing the school bus as a child and like, you know, then I run faster and all of a sudden I'm an Olympic, you know, gold medalist. It was literally just, they had different channels, so you could just say, oh, I want to watch your question. Just go, and that's what it was. It's like, oh wow, this is actually pretty democratic Olympic coverage compared to whatever it comes on here. At the time I was still busy, you know, working and performing, but we were in a cafe, I think it might have been after a rehearsal, just talking as we would do, and then one of the medal ceremonies was on, and then up comes the Star Spangled Banner. And it's just like, oh wow, wait. That means someone from the United States just won a gold medal. Oh wow, wait, am I supposed to stand? Wait, do I care? Well, who won? Oh, okay. Yeah, but, okay, well what? And it was so much internal conflict of, well, you hear that song that ties you to this land that you were birthed in, but then it's like, well, you know, you hear that sonic impact of like, oh, but does that carry me somewhere? You know, because I mean, for us, there's certain things you hear, and certain, you know, sonic elements that will come in there, and you know, that it grabs you like, oh, certain things.
That was your Marvin Gaye face for me.
Marvin, oh, okay, well, hey.
That would be my Marvin Gaye face.
Oh, okay. That's the thing, you know, so it's like, you know, want you to want you to just like I want you. You know, so when that comes on, for me, that just, you know, that takes me back, you know, Stony Island, 87th Street, South Side of Chicago. You know, just the many, just cousins, you know, auntie. And so like that gets just like, oh yeah, that grabs me. But then, you know, and I'm not in Chicago. It didn't matter if I was in Brazil or something, and that Marvin comes on, oh man. But then, you know, the Star Spangled Banner comes on, and it's immediate conflict. You know, it's like, well, is it pride or is it, you know, repulsion? Like, what is that? You know, it's not a, there's no draping of the sound, there's no hook within the song, within that song or that sound that, oh, that's the scary part, maybe there is a hook in that sound that you're locked to, that you can't ever, you know, unshackle yourself from.
Well, I would like to challenge you in this way. I mean, I'm looking at all of the things that you do. Right? You don't just do one thing. You're not an artist who is bound by, so you can move, so you dance. You use your voice, so you have a band. You do lots of things. And so in that same way that you're able to hold artistic complexity, I'm wondering if maybe in this moment you can also hold the complexity of hearing or singing or participating in that song and in those words and not have to reject it and to see who you are in your American self or your partially American self. And what does that feel like? And is it okay? Can you give your asking you because I'm asking myself also, and I think a lot of people are asking that question in this moment and trying to sort out where they are, and maybe from moment to moment it changes, but I wanted to begin our conversation in song and somehow consecrating this space and this moment that we're about to be in with you in a way that also invites complexity. How are you doing?
I'm actually doing okay.
Okay, good.
Otherwise. I mean, no, in all respects, it's actually been a pretty good day.
Yeah. Tell me a little bit about this band.
So, the band is really piecing together of various people in my life and periods in my life as well. I got the commission from Harlem Stage in 2015 to be a part of the 90th anniversary celebration of James Baldwin. That was going to be for E-Moves, and it was at several institutions around the city. And so they invited me to present a dance work, a premiere dance work about, or be inspired by James Baldwin or his works or all of the above. And as soon as they gave me the invitation, I was like, great, I know exactly what I want to do. You know, we were going through the process and, preparing once I got everyone together. Vince is one of my oldest friends in New York. He was down immediately. I knew Jeremy would be down. He just was like, okay, just tell me what rehearsals are. Jesse and I met, and she was like, oh, cool. You know, I would love to, you know, see what it's about. And, you know, there we were in the studio. So it was really about selecting which ball and text were going to be delivered and how. The how actually was kind of, that was really evident. It was like, okay, we're going to really deliver this as loud and as fast as possible. So, come Harlem Stage, fast forward, then they finally believed we were doing a punk show. You know, we were showing up. And they were like, oh, wait, you're actually there. I'm like, yeah, this is the thing. And, you know, we did the thing. And most of the responses were a confusion or also a realization that none of the text I was saying was my own. It's not, you know, once we start, it's not me anymore. That's all Jimmy. He was a rock star. So the urgency of carrying his words and his lyrics and his text forward with this sound, which also is our sound, which, you know, again, is usually not recognized. It really sent a new sense of, it's kind of like, oh wow, my room is actually, it's like you clean the room and it's just like, oh, okay, I actually do have white walls and not gray. You know, and so that's how the band kind of came together. And it was really just to, I guess to really just test the limits on how we thought we could present the work or do justice or just honor really the work of Baldwin.
The texts that you are going to perform tonight, from which books or essays or?
The first text is, it's a long form poem called A Lover's Question, is the first one. The last one, I believe, might be from Giovanni's Room, The Giver. And then the second one, I'm not sure, that is the, of course now I'm forgetting the title. And then we're gonna do a fourth one tonight. Actually, that's not James Baldwin. And I'm not gonna tell people who it is, but hopefully maybe they can be like, oh, wait a minute, is this? So, you know, we'll see. We're still experimenting. was something that we wanted to try when we were in the studio last time. So, yeah, we'll see.
Excellent. Wondering if anyone out here has a question that they'd like to ask. They're all just looking at us. You're not curious about anything that just have looked at that hand back there.
At the last prelude you were at, I asked you how you felt dance occurred breaking through the narrative of voices in American society. Now on the flip side, screaming and playing loud music, how do you feel that that has a different effect on breaking through the narrative of what we're facing?
So we're talking about breaking through the narrative of what we're facing right now with dance and with music, and this choice this evening being music.
Well, we, how do I explain this? So we just finished 8 years, and I guess it is now, you know, I guess a period of post 8 years of an Obama family presidency. I am gonna reiterate that word, Obama family presidency. And with whatever that means. And there's always kind of an expectancy from a white American majority of a certain type of behavior that's acceptable from, I guess, a certain type of black person, I guess, in the sense, I guess I'm speaking now on respectability politics. Respectability actions on how to properly, I guess, protest or how to properly insert oneself into the landscape of diversity hiring or insert oneself into teaching racial equity. And then you have what always feeds America, it's kind of culture correction, is the black youth, which never asks for permission or waits for anyone. And there's no sense of decorum or in decorum in the sense of meeting, you know, this white middle class standard of this is how you behave. And it's just like, no, this is what we're gonna do. And if it's loud, it's loud. If it's brash, it's brash. If it's gonna come at you at 100 miles per hour, you know, that's what it's gonna do. But it's also gonna pierce through a lot of the veneer and the fragility that exists to kind of maintain an oppressive facade. And so that's kind of the place we're at.
I think it's a great, did you want to ask something? Yes.
It's sort of a follow-up, maybe. You're playing punk music wearing a suit in recital hall. Is that part of what you were just talking about with doing what you want, where you want to do it, kind of idea that I'm just, you know?
Well,
Jimmy always was rocking a suit. If you look at him, he always had on a pretty nice suit. He was always about the business. So that's kind of a way to honor him. And them, I should say.
Anyone else? Yes? So the question is, what made you decide to go with music rather than choreography?
Certain times with dance, and this I actually when I moved back to the United States, I made a pledge to myself. I said, I can no longer make work where if someone, where at the end of the performance, if someone says, oh, that was nice, then I failed. Period. And dance has a tendency to do that a lot. And it's just like, well, what's the damn point?
Well, what is the point? What is it that you're trying to solve or provoke?
I don't know if I can solve. Well, it's definitely to move, and it's definitely to agitate. And then I guess one of the things I often ask back is, well, if you're more afraid of me than you are of white supremacy, then you need to ask yourself a question.
Okay.
Because if you're more afraid of this group of people on stage doing what we do in the way that we're doing it, than you are of the system that is causing us to do what we do, I don't know if that fear is coming from a place of real awareness.
So let's have at it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, buddy.
Thank you.
audience. Just before.
in the air. You could see it, you could put it out in the air. You could see it, you could put it out in the air. Down goes on my tray. So children sit in the chair. Like a cat across my path.
Give her a smile!